Welcome to another hour of Highway 89, Utah's most scenic musical byway. I'm Eric Glissmeyer, and this hour highlights Utah Symphony and Utah Opera's upcoming Opera Hits program on July 20th. Every summer, for nearly a decade, the Symphony closes shop in Utah's capital and heads off to the mountains for the Deer Valley Music Festival. There, families can lay out a blanket and picnic before a concert begins, watch the sunset as the symphony takes the stage, and hear repertoire from Michael Jackson to Claude Debussy. Utah Opera has often been part of the festival, too, staging light operas like Gilbert and Sullivan's H.M.S. Pinafore and featuring local opera stars and the Utah Opera Chorus. Joining me in the studio right now are mezzo-soprano Sishel Claverie and pianist Thomas Klassen. I'll chat with them in just a little bit, but let's get started with an aria from the opera Carmen.
Thank you.
Listening to Highway 89 live on Classical 89 and Sirius XM 143 BYU Radio. I'm Eric Glissmeyer, and that was Sishel Claverie performing Bizet's Habanera. Sishel, you've been artist in residence with Utah Opera for the last year and will be for another year.
Yes.
What exactly does that mean to be an artist in residence?
Well, it is a program designed for young singers to go from college studies or any kind of music studies that they would engage in into a professional career, because that's hard, like in any career, but it is also true in opera. And what they do is to give performance opportunities like supporting roles on the main stage or covering main roles for the main stage as well. And alongside with coachings and master classes and other sorts of classes to keep training, because we're in the process of becoming professional singers. So that's basically it. And we do also outreach. There's a lot of performance opportunities as well.
As part of this assignment as artist in residence, you've had to perform in some pretty rural parts of Utah, even
yes.
in one-room schoolhouses, right?
Yeah, with like 10 kids, something like that.
That's
yes.
very small groups sometimes.
Yeah.
You once did 12 of these performances in just 5 days. I'm
yeah.
wondering what that was like.
It is very demanding to sing for children, because they don't lie. If they're bored or something, they're going to show it. So you have to keep their attention with the music mostly. I mean, we play around. We actually improvise a lot in our group. After 3 months, we knew each other very well. So we would play jokes with each other to keep it fresh. And the kids react so well. And it's really enjoyable to see the kids react to the music and comedy or the drama that is going on stage. And so what we do is a game show for the kids. We do several programs for, you know, the age ranges. But for the small kids, we do something like Who Wants to Be an Opera Star? You know, reminding Who Wants to Be a Millionaire?
Sure.
And so we are on podiums and we answer questions about opera. That way we teach the kids about opera. And then we do like who can hold the longest note. So we are, you know, singing our heart out and counting the minutes that we can hold the longest note. The kids just love it, and then we hear them singing in the hallways, and we get mail, you know, with drawings of music notes and singers.
Oh, that's fantastic!
Yes.
So you feel like you're making some sort of an impact? And
I do. I was actually in an audition in California, in LA, and The guy behind me, who was also auditioning, saw my luggage with a Utah tag, and he was like, "Oh, you are from Utah?" And I'm like, "Well, I'm working there for Utah Opera. I'm from Utah too, and Utah Opera went to my school when I was little, and they were singing opera, and I was so shocked, and I'm here now. I'm an opera singer, and I'm auditioning." I'm like, "Whoa,
yeah.
This is, I'm planting a seed." It's
yeah.
lovely.
It's wonderful to be a part of something like that, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it is, it is.
You're originally from Mexico City, is that
That's
right?
That's right, yeah.
And it doesn't snow a lot in Mexico City. Pretty rare for that to ever happen.
Yeah.
How have you adjusted to the winter here in Utah?
Well, it was a mild winter for...
Well, that's true. This one was pretty good, wasn't it?
Yeah. And I also lived 7 years in Houston, Texas. Like it snowed like once... And it stayed there for like half an hour or something. So it's been nice. It was terrifying for me to drive for the first time on the snow.
Yeah.
But
when you're not used to it, that can be a little bit scary.
That can be scary. But I mean, it's wonderful. The mountains just make it all better. It's gorgeous.
Well, it's nice to have you here. And
thank you.
Certainly it's fantastic to have you singing for us this evening. Let's have some more music now. Something by Leonard Bernstein from Candide. It's a piece called I Am Easily Assimilated. Once more, we're hearing from mezzo-soprano Sishel Claverie and at the piano, Thomas Klassen.
I was not born in canzonish Hispania. My mother came from Ruvno Gubernia. But now I'm here, I'm dancing a tango. I am easily assimilated. I am so easily assimilated. I never learned a human language. My mother spoke a high middle Polish. In 1/2 hour, I'm talking Spanish. Por favor, toreador! I am easily assimilated. I am so easily assimilated. It's easy, it's ever so easy. I'm Spanish, I'm suddenly Spanish. And you must be Spanish too, like the natives do these days. You have to be in the majority.
Just love that music. It's from Candide by Leonard Bernstein. I am easily assimilated. And we heard mezzo-soprano Sishel Claverie and pianist Thomas Klassen. This is Highway 89 live on Classical 89 and Sirius XM 143 BYU Radio. I'm Eric Glissmeyer, and this hour highlights Utah Symphony and Utah Opera's Opera Hits program at the Deer Valley Music Festival in Park City, Utah. Time now to chat a little bit with our pianist, Thomas Klassen. Tom, tonight you're playing the piano, but for the Deer Valley performance, you'll be on stage singing in the opera chorus. And you've been with the chorus for a good while, nearly 15 years, is that right?
That's correct, yeah.
What's been your favorite Utah opera production when you've sung in the chorus?
You know, it's hard for me to pick just one. Turandot is a huge favorite of mine. That the music was just so massive, and the artistry that was going on was just amazing. But in terms of participation and chorus participation, Grapes of Wrath has to be the top for me. The chorus was given so many meaningful roles, and for me, as a Midwestern, I could really just really zone in and just identify with the music and with the story that was going on. And so that was an amazing show for me.
Have you always been an opera fan?
No, I haven't. I've come late to opera, and the bug has bitten me late in life, basically. I really didn't ever go see an opera until I came to Utah, and until my wife Carolyn got me sort of hooked on it and into the music and into shows. So it's wonderful.
Going back to the upcoming Opera Hits program, what do you like about the Deer Valley Music Festival performances?
I just like, personally, that they're live and they're out in the open. For me, there's something magical that happens when you're out in the open. You're out of your normal environment and out of kind of the halls that we designate for music performance.
Sure.
And so they take on this vitality and life for me that's just really amazing.
What were the early Deer Valley opera productions like?
So the ones, are you talking about the Gilbert and Sullivan?
Yeah,
ones?
I think so. What'd they do? H.M.S. Pinafore, the
right.
Mikado.
Yeah, I think we did all
Pirates
the
too,
four
maybe.
Of them.
Or...
They were the top for me. I mean, we got to be so involved with them, and I sort of joke with my wife and my family that there's nothing better than putting on tights and dancing and singing, you know, up there. But it's wonderful. And, you know, again, there's just when I walk into that Snow Park Lodge and I can smell it, I know that it brings back all of that to me. So I love that experience.
Yeah.
Those are personal experiences with that.
Yeah, we're so fortunate to have the mountains so close to us and to experience the fresh air and just the scenery with all that music is is wonderful, isn't it?
It is.
Well, thanks for talking with me. I'll let you make your way back to the piano, and we'll get ready to hear one of the best-known arias from American opera, Summertime from Porgy and Bess. Once again, mezzo-soprano Sishel Claverie and Thomas Klassen at the piano on Highway 89.
Summer,
Summertime from Porgy and Bess, music by George Gershwin. And you're listening to Highway 89, live on Classical 89 and Sirius XM 143 BYU Radio. We heard mezzo-soprano Sishel Claverie, and at the piano we had Thomas Klassen. I'm Eric Glissmeyer, and I'm speaking once again with Sishel Claverie. As a mezzo-soprano, you're sometimes cast in trouser roles, which is opera speak for a male character performed by a woman. Uh-huh. How has that challenged you?
Well, that's the fun part, right? It's, preparing for those roles is my favorite part of the process sometimes, because there's a lot of research of physicality and movement that has to go into it. I remember the first time I had to do a pants roll, I was in college, and my first role was a medieval warrior for Handel's Rinaldo, and I was like, how do I go about this, you know? And, you know, my college was, well, just go and observe men. I'm like, well, yeah, of course. Luckily for me, I've always have a fascination for observing people. It's just, I mean, no judging, just, you know, appreciation of people. They're just fascinating. So it was not hard for me, but then I was like, but man, they just have another anatomy. I have these hips. I don't know what to do with them, you know? Yeah. So I decided to observe women who didn't move like very feminine, you know, what we consider feminine. So I took my medieval warrior from my geology teacher, who was very tall and, you know, very square and you know, very tough with her movements. And I just observed. I didn't pay attention to geology class, obviously. And and for my second role, it was Massenet's Cherubin, which is another take on Cherubino,
right?
The famous role by Mozart. And I was lucky to find on campus this girl. She was wearing this, you know, mix of old and new, like jeans and then a vest and then like an early 20th century jacket or something. She looked like Oliver Twist, and she was like just walking like a boy. It was like, she's perfect. So I followed her around everywhere. And I was like, okay, how does she peel an apple? And she started to, like, she spread her legs a little bit more and just be very rude with her movements. And so I studied her until she got mad at me. but anyways, but in the end, it's all about nuances, because you don't want to play a boy. You want to play the emotion. You want to play the situation the character finds himself in. So you don't want to be a caricature of a man. You want to be nuanced and authentic in what's going on.
Well, that's very interesting. I'd never thought of preparing for a pants role that way. I think it sounds like it's worked out perfectly.
Yeah, I think it is.
What role do you dream of performing someday?
Wow. I think, you know, the holy grail for mezzos is Carmen, of course.
Yeah.
It's a very special role. It's also very terrifying, because it's very hard to make it your own, since very big luminaries have, you know, make a huge mark on that role.
Yeah,
so it's hard to...
People have it in their mind, don't they, of how they want the role to be performed.
Exactly. So you don't want to insult anyone, and you want to, you know, kind of please everyone, but you want to also be your own artist and do it, you know, the way you do it. So I think I have to mature for that role a lot. And also Charlotte by...
Werther.
It's just a gorgeous role and based on a gorgeous novel, so... That's my dream role, too.
Well, let's hear you sing again.
Sure.
One of my favorite characters in all of opera, the feisty Rosina, talking about how she has fallen in love with someone named Lindoro. She also tells us how docile she is. That is, unless someone crosses her. This is Una Voce Poco Fa from The Barber of Seville by Rossini, Sishel Claverie, mezzo-soprano, and Thomas Klassen at the piano.
Suonò il mio cor ferito è già
Choo!
Una Voce Poco Fa from The Barber of Seville by Gioacchino Rossini. Well, we've come to the end of another episode of Highway 89. Sishel, thanks for coming and singing for us.
Thank you very much. It was my pleasure.
Oh, lovely voice and just a beautiful, solid technique. So fun to listen to you. Thomas, thank you so much for coming and playing the piano.
You're welcome. My pleasure as well.
I know that both of you had very little notice on this this engagement, but you both did a very good job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sishel Claverie is a mezzo-soprano from Mexico City and currently an artist in residence at Utah Opera. Thomas Klassen, a rehearsal pianist for Utah Opera, and he has sung in the opera chorus for more than 15 years. Highway 89 takes you to any number of musical destinations, every one of them musical and memorable. We always welcome your comments and questions about our programming. And for information about this show, you can simply email us at highway89@byu.edu. Highway 89 is a production of BYU Broadcasting. The recording engineer is Mark Waite. The show's producer is Jackie Tataishi. And I'm Eric Glissmeyer. Thanks for listening.